TV lovers, Marvel lovers, just lovers of the craft of writing and creating.
And also lovers of cool leather jackets, man.
And lovers of cool leather jackets.
And also vintage Doctor Strange t-shirts.
I had to hit it up with Marvel, man, because y'all are really representing right now. How does it feel to, like, have a hit Netflix series about, I mean, in this universe where Marvel has just been touching so many assets of diversity and great story and storyline? How does it feel like being in that world?
I'm just honestly just happy that we got invited, you know what I'm saying? But not, it's one thing to get invited, it's another thing to really be able to do your thing, you know what I'm saying? It's like to play the records that you wanted to play when you're being invited for your DJ set, instead of playing for the crowd, playing for what your crowd likes, and then expanding the universe, or what I like to call the Wu-Tangification of the Marvel Universe. What I loved is the fact that they really gave us the opportunity to do our thing, but do it in a way that fit within the rest of Marvel, so it doesn't feel different. It's kind of how, like, what James Gunn did with Guardians of the Galaxy, where he got into 70s AM rock and roll and kind of added a new flavor, you know, to Marvel. And we, on the television side, with Luke Cage, got to do something similar in terms of 90s hip-hop. So, I mean, I'm just honestly, I'm shocked that we got away with it, and I'm really glad that people dug it.
How did you feel, first off? Because I know you got, I seen the tweets and stuff going out. When Cotton Mouth died, people were like having a fit, you know. But how did you create that arc for that character? And how did it feel to see Mahershala go off from his fame from Cotton Mouth and then go to do Moonlight? Not that he started here, you know, and get all these honors.
Well, okay, I'll let you in on one secret. If you notice, Mahershala has the same haircut in Moonlight, Hidden Figures, and Luke Cage. And the reason for that is he was doing all three simultaneously. And I still to this day don't know how he would, like, you know, be on set as Cottonmouth one day and then fly down to Florida and do Moonlight, or go to Virginia to do Hidden Figures. I don't actually know where they filmed Hidden Figures. I think maybe Atlanta. But the thing is, was that that's how versatile he is. And so, if anything, we were just proud. We weren't like saying, okay, oh man, you left us behind. We were like, you know, he brought such light to our show, and then that light just kind of, everyone was just happy to have what he was doing. And I'm just, what he did as Cottonmouth is just remarkable. And to the point where people are like, you know, there have been tweets saying, like, we don't care, just bring him back from the dead. It's Marvel, you know. It's like,
we want Cottonmouth hashtags going out.
You know what I'm saying? So I think that's pretty funny, but I don't want to be like, you know, Luke Cage's Rick Pitino saying Larry Bird ain't coming out of that locker room, ladies and gentlemen. But at the same time, it's just like, I'm happy that he left such an impact, because he left an impact on all of us. But then at the same time, I mean, like, you know, we're going to see more evolution of everybody that comes back. So without revealing who, this is going to be a fun ride.
I know last time you said that the writers kind of, y'all kind of were like on this base, are kind of work together, don't work together. But now that Luke Cage is being teased for the Defenders, and you got all these other characters in the Defenders, like, did this season, was there a little bit more collaboration with that follow-up show, the Defenders? Or?
Well, I mean, the thing is that Melissa, you know, Marco, Doug, myself, we all know each other, you know what I'm saying? So it's like, if anybody had a question about Luke Cage, at least, you know, Marco and Doug, as they were building Defenders, you know, it was open door policy. The same way that it was also open door when we were doing Luke Cage, to say, hey, what's going on with Daredevil, or to go to Melissa and say, hey, you know, how does our storyline intersect with Jessica? The thing, as always is, particularly with Marvel staffs and Marvel showrunners, is that we're part of a Marvel family. And so it's almost like Motown. It's almost like, you know, if you were Temptation, you can go see what the Four Tops are doing. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, you might not appear on each other's records, but it's just like, it's all recorded in the same building, you know?
And last question. Everybody kind of, like, you know, broke their virginity of binge watching with Netflix. A lot of people, you know?
Yeah.
I want to know, like, have you binge watched any other show on Netflix?
Oh, yeah.
And what's the first show you binge watched?
Well, I can't tell you the first show I binge watched, but my most recent binges was, I binged Dear White People, which is amazing, and I also binged the second season of Master of None, which is also incredible. It's easier to do half-hour shows because it's not as much of a time commitment, but the thing is, that's interesting, is that there's so much drama in Master of None, and there's so much drama in, you know, Dear White People, you almost forget that they're supposed to be comedies, but they're also funny as hell. And it's just amazing just how how much depth there is. And so the same thing where we were able to be surprisingly funky and have surprising depth in Luke Cage, I also looked to what they, you know, to what Aziz, you know, did with Master of None. I also to see what Justin and everybody did with Dear White People, and just be like, man, it's just like the competition is just dope. It's just like you looking around and you're just like, it's just inspiring because everyone's doing their thing and everyone's able to really bring a, you know, unique perspective. And so it's just dope.